these days. How to combine multiple classifiers?
It actually, well, so what do they say? Well, they say that, you know what, we know that no learning algorithm is perfect, right? So it doesn't make sense to ask the question what the best learning algorithm is, right? The only question which is meaningful to ask is what would be the best algorithm for the particular domain. And in different domains, there would be different algorithms. But very often, you don't really know, you don't have a good reason to believe that a certain algorithm will be the best algorithm for the domain. So what should you do in that case? Well, the idea is to utilize different learning algorithms to see that even if individually, right, each one is limited and each one is not particularly good, but when you combine them together, okay, you will get a much, much better result. Now, how you combine is a different matter. By the way, you can think of this Bayesian averaging as one way of combining, right? So here you basically what you do, you calculate the posterior. That posterior gives you, okay, so this is the distribution of the parameters, but each parameter value defines a particular end result, a particular, say, learner. And then you take this weighted average of them, right, with the posterior probabilities. So here they say, okay, so let's not necessarily do this Bayesian thing, but we actually want to do this combination in such a way that the results actually have much better accuracy. Now, we know from our regular human experience that this is often the case, right? That's why, you know, when people ask for expert advice, they usually don't rely on a single expert, right? So they ask multiple experts and incorporate this, all the advice into this. If you remember, I don't know how many of you have seen those old shows. You remember Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Has anybody watched it?
Yeah.
Some of you have. You remember that one of the lifelines was to ask the audience there, which is actually, usually you don't really have individual experts or main or whatever, but you remember that for certain types of questions, this average audience advice was unbeatable, right? So that if you're really not sure what to do, you, yes?
The question is, for example, if I have three clocks or three watches, then in the time, I don't believe which clock is right or wrong.
Well, and if you believe that actually, you know, that there is a good reason to believe that one of the watches is fast and another watch is slow.
But you don't know that.
I don't. That's why what I will do, I will take all three time measurements and I will average them. Okay? And if you you don't assume any systematic problem, like, for example, that all these watches come from a faulty batch, okay? And because of that faulty batch, they are all actually fast. Okay, so if that's the case, it's not gonna help. It may even hurt. But if you don't believe that to be the case, if you think that, okay, so there is some kind of a randomness in what they do, then that's actually a very good example. I would take their time and I would average it. Okay? So this is what people often do. So basically the idea is that we have to create what we call base learners. Often those will be very simple learning algorithms. Okay, that should be easy to create. You'll see we'll talk about some additional properties of them. In many cases they have to then stay brought up over that stuff, blah blah blah. But then we're going to combine the results, right? To get hopefully better results. And they can be very different. So they can be completely different algorithms. And you'll see examples of that. So one algorithm can be, I don't know, discriminant analysis. and another one can be, say, decision trees, and another one can be nearest neighbor. Okay? So they can be really substantively different algorithms, and we can combine the results. Or they can be algorithms of the same type, but parameterized. And we use different values of hyperparameters. Okay? And then we will end up with different algorithms. There are other cases that are possible. It may be that we have this situation where, say, a certain phenomenon is represented by several different sets of attributes. Okay? For example, when I talk, there is a sound recording of what I say, right? And there is a video recording of what I say, right? And they actually both communicate information about what I say, right? So the sound one does, but also the movement of my lips, also in the tongue, communicate very important information, okay? It actually language dependent. It is more important for some languages rather than others. I don't know if you know that. Do you know that?
We know that.
Well, this is one of the reasons, for example, why in this country it is highly unusual to have a dub foreign movie. It's not just a financial issue. So if you see, even when they show it for the Oscars and for those Oscar winners, when they show them in the theaters, they show them subtitles. They don't show them dub. Okay? In many other countries, when they show a foreign movie, very often they will show dub, not subtitle. Well, because English is particularly sensitive. So English speakers, they may not realize it, maybe at the subconscious level, they look at the lip movement. Okay, because when you speak English, you actually, your lips move a lot.
So they're used to that, so they watch a dub movie.
When they watch a dub movie, it's like, it's weird that they hear that it sounds, the sound says one thing, and the visual says something which is completely different, and there is this cognitive dissonance.
Yeah, they will enjoy
that. No, that's the reason, because and often people don't realize that there is this. I don't know how is it in Arabic. Is it dumb?
No, we have Indian movies that usually are that. But usually, I don't get dubbed too. Me personally, I prefer subtitles. Yeah.
Well,
maybe because of the
well, it means that in Arabic it's like in English.
Yeah.
I can tell you that in Russian, the lip movement is very subdued. So Russian speakers don't care.
And so like France and Germany, the English movies are all dubbed.
So in Russian, foreign language movies are dubbed. No big deal. So there is no cognitive dissonance. Because there is no this subconscious watching of the lips. Okay? It actually, at the end of the day, you are too young to remember, but actually even some expressions, so when George Bush the senior was running for president in 1988, one of the big issues there at that time was this, you know, Reagan was fighting the increase in taxes, and there was a very big deficit, and people were saying that, well, there was no other way we would need to raise taxes. So one of the campaign promises that Bush the senior made, he said on the campaign trail, he said, watch my lips, no new taxes. You see, he said, not listen to what I say, he said, watch my lips. Watch my lips, no new taxes. And then he raised taxes, and then Bill Clinton crashed. So in 1992, it was a big deal during the presidential campaign. They kept playing it over and over again, this watch my lips. So it's a, and you know, to an English speaker, I mean, it's, I think it's really at the subconscious level.
Yeah, I think it's a thing.
So people don't even realize that. So, but what does it mean? It means that you have two different modalities.
So you have the attributes that describe the sound. You have the attributes that describe, say, the movement of lips. And they actually, they describe the same thing. So if you want, say, to recognize certain words, what do you do with those attributes? Do you try to feed them into a single algorithm? May not sound as a good idea, because, you know, generally speaking, you would assume that sound processing and video processing should be done differently. So that's the reason why you may want to utilize different learners that would utilize different modalities, different representations of the same object. Right? And then you would combine the results. Okay, so that's another way how you do this. How, why you may want to combine different learners. They will give you different results. So if you have a number of those, that may be very good, because basically what you are doing, you are looking at the same problem from different angles. Okay? That's, by the way, also, this is not a new thing. Particularly the military, for a very long time, had this problem of information fusion, as they talk about it. And it was due to the fact that they actually have information about the same thing coming from a number of very different sensors. It's very similar to what we talked about. And they needed methods that would fuse the results. Because you have to decide what is going on when you have a problem. Another issue is, you may have to construct your learners on different data sets. Okay? And depending on the data set that you construct your learner on, it will be different. Because, you know, depending on what you put in the training, you will get different results. If you have very large data sets, this may be a very reasonable idea to do. See what happens, what kind of learners you get when you build them on different data sets. How you construct those subsets, that's a separate matter. You can do it randomly, you can do it in a systematic fashion if you know how to partition the space. But again, okay, so there are a number of different ways how you want to combine it. You also may want to actually view your problem as consisting of a number of different sub-problems, right? So maybe representing different aspects of the same thing. And then your aggregated decision will be based on those subproblems. Now, when you create those learners, you want to make sure that they do different things. So basically, you know, diversity is a popular word these days. So for all these techniques, it is critical to have diversified learners. If the learners have no diversity, it's like, you know, there are several different schools of thought, and you got your experts from one of them. Right? Then they're going to be telling you the same thing. Then there will be no value in trying in having this whole business. Right? So you do want diversity. It's of essence. But at the same time, you want to have reasonable accuracy. Now, keep in mind that these two goals are contradictory. Because if all your learners are highly accurate, always, by definition, they're correlated. Okay? Because they always give you very good results. Right? So, in a way, there will be a trade-off here. And you'll see that in most cases, what people do, they use simple ones. So they're going to be giving you different results, but also their results are not going to be that great. It turns out that you don't really need great results. You need reasonable results. It's very interesting. You'll see we'll get particularly to things like other boost. And
it's all about getting something reasonable. If you get something reasonable, but you keep iterating and averaging, you will boost it. You will get actually to a very good level, but so in a way, diversity is more important than accuracy, as long as accuracy is not total trash.
Okay. Are these like hybrid methods?
Yes.
So these are the hybrid methods.
Yes. Yeah, but there are differences that how hybrid they are. Some are based on the same type of algorithms. Some utilize completely different algorithms.
And these multiple on the same data set, this would use, but different parts of the data set?
Well, it depends. When you say the same data set, say, as I told you.
Example, yeah.
Yeah, well, you can say there is this one sample, but like in that case with multiple modalities. So if that sample, so there is this description of voice.
Let's say it's one model. You want to use two, like let's say.
If it is one model, for example, I fix the model, but the model will be adjusted to the data. I can use different. I can use different subsamples. I can do it randomly. If I have a systematic reason to partition the space, I may do it that way. Okay, so the answer is all depends. I mean, it is not. We're not talking about a single method. We're not even talking about a single family of methods. Yeah. You'll see that this chapter actually it's a short chapter, by the way, but it is a combination of a great number of different things. Okay, and this is something which existed for a while in certain forms. So a linear combination of experts, I can tell you that I'm aware of the publications from the early 1970s where people would consider linear combinations of experts. There was something called at that time the so-called method of the committee. Okay? But what is interesting, I would say that the explosion was probably in the last 15-20 years. So you can trace it all the way back, but it really, I mean, it started picking up in the 1990s, literally, this whole activity. That was, 1990s were very active, okay, early 2000s were also people were, and I think people are still very doing this very much, and it's like, they consider them like meta-methods. Okay, some are extremely popular, so when we get to them, I'll tell you. Which ones people consider to be extremely popular. Any other questions? Do we have to have a break? Yeah, let's have a, but don't delay, okay? So we'll start not at 2:30, but we'll start at 2:27.